me in Romans chapter 9 this morning. Romans chapter 9. Anybody in the room know what the Hodge conjecture is? Anybody ever even heard of the Hodge conjecture? Anybody? You have?
I don't remember what it is.
Okay, he's heard of it. You would have to be somebody who has studied math more than I have to know what the Hodge conjecture is, because the Hodge conjecture is one of the top six unsolved mathematic questions. This is in specifically in algebraic geometry, and I'm going to explain to you the Hodge conjecture, but I can't, okay? I've read about it, I looked at it, I couldn't understand most of the words in the paragraph I was reading. It's for people who are really serious math geeks. It was really first presented in 1950 when a Scottish mathematician by the name of William Hodge presented his conjecture at the International Council of Mathematics, and since that time, mathematicians have been trying to either prove or disprove the Hodge conjecture. And in fact, they will give you, I say they will, it's the Clay Mathematics Institute will give you $1 million if you can either prove or disprove the Hodge conjecture. Now let me just warn you, don't go home this afternoon and say I'm going to try and figure this out, okay? Because for 67 years, top mathematic minds around the world have been trying to figure out the Hodge conjecture. Now, most mathematicians would probably tell you there is an answer, we just haven't landed on it yet. We just haven't been able to figure it out. We haven't thought about it. It's a conundrum. It's beyond us at this point. And it's possible somebody may one day prove or disprove the Hodge conjecture. But there is another unsolved math mystery that's been around since the 4th century BC when Euclid was alive. You've heard of Euclidean geometry, right? Euclid proposed the question of, are there any odd perfect numbers? And that riddle has puzzled mathematicians since the 4th century BC. Nobody can give you a yes or no answer to that question. Now, I bring that up because mathematicians are not the only people in the world who have their conundrums, who have their conjectures, who have things that are mysteries to them. Theology has its own set of unprovable assertions or problems, don't we? I mean, for example, how can God be three persons and one essence? People have been wrestling with how to express that and how to understand it, how to get our arms around that for centuries. And we've heard explanations, but at the end of the day, when it comes to the doctrine of the Trinity, we go, we can't fully understand it. All we can do is believe it. How can Jesus be fully God and fully man? That's another one of those conundrums we come up with. How will the events leading up to the return of Jesus unfold in human history? The Bible gives us insight, but there's a lot of conjecture about that, right? Maybe the granddaddy of them all in terms of theological conjecture is, if God is all-loving, you know where I'm going with this, right? And all-wise, how come there is what? Evil. Why is there pain? Why do we experience that in our lifetime? Well, we've spent the last two Sundays, and again this Sunday, we're going to be looking at one of those sticky, unsolvable issues in the Bible, the issue of God's sovereignty and how man's free will relate to that. And this is something that since the Bible was written, people have struggled with trying to get their arms around it. And I hope that our time together in Romans chapter 9 over the last couple of weeks has maybe given you some insight into this, but I'm also smart enough to know that our three Sundays in Romans 9 are not sufficient to cause everybody to go, oh, well, thank you for solving that for us. Now we get it. Now we can put that whole issue to rest. Here's the crux of the dilemma we're dealing with here. We believe the Bible teaches that God is completely sovereign when it comes to the affairs of men. Nothing happens that God does not superintend. R.C. Sproul says it this way. He says, if there is a random molecule functioning on its own apart from God's sovereignty, then God is not God. He is God over everything. We believe the Bible teaches that. Nothing happens outside of his will, outside of his control. He either ordains or allows whatever comes to pass. That's what we believe. And at the same time, we believe that each one of us, all people, have free will, and we exercise our own judgment as free moral agents, making choices that we make without coercion, choices in all matters of life, including the choice of whether to reject him or whether to accept Jesus as the Messiah. We are free to do as we please. And you go, but wait, those two can't fit together. Welcome to the Hodge conjecture, okay? I'll put up $1 million if anybody can solve this one for me. And I think the what we have to keep in mind is that the Bible teaches two things that are not contradictory, but they are what are called an antinomy. These are two truths that are held in tension, and the full understanding of it is beyond us. So how does this dilemma manifest itself, this free will versus sovereignty? Well, it manifests itself in a variety of ways. For example, is it up to you to decide what you're going to have for lunch today? Or has God preordained it from the foundation of the world? Are you responsible to make that choice? And are you responsible for whatever consequences that come with whatever your choice is? If you decide that you're going to eat Twinkies and Ho-Hos for lunch today, are you responsible for the consequences that will come with that? And finally, if you change your mind in the next half hour, is that God who did that or is that you? You see the dilemma. That's in a simple decision like what we do each day. But the big question is, what about our decision to either surrender to Christ or to reject Christ? That's the big decision every person in the world has to make throughout their lifetime. Is that decision up to us to make by our free will? Or has God sovereignly determined what choice we will make? And the answer is yes to both of those. Yes to both of those. Do we have control over the issues we face today? Let me show you some interesting proverbs. Look at, you may know Proverbs 21, verse 1. Here's what it says. The king's heart is a stream of water in the hand of the Lord. He, that is God, turns it wherever he will. The heart of the king is in God's hands, and he directs it. By the way, that's for every king in this room. That's not just the king. That's all of us who are kings. God directs our steps. Here's how we know this. Proverbs 16:9. The heart of man plans his ways, but the Lord establishes his steps. Or Proverbs 16:33. The lot is cast into the lap, but every decision is from the Lord. You see what these proverbs tell us? They tell us that man is involved, man is acting as a free agent, and God's in control of everything. Now, are those verses comforting to you or troubling to you? Maybe a little of both. Is it comforting to know that God's in control of everything, or is it troubling to know that you're not in control of everything? And what we've been seeing as we're working through Romans chapter 9 is that this idea of God being in control comes down to the issue of our own salvation, that God is sovereign over this, and at the same time, man has a responsibility in this area. And how those two work together is indeed a tension. I want to point something out to you. Romans chapter 9 and the doctrine of election that is addressed in this, the doctrine of predestination, was written by an individual who was perhaps one of the greatest evangelists ever to live, a man who faced torture and strife and hardship to bring the gospel to the world. There is no tension in Paul's mind between God's sovereignty and man's responsibility to respond and our responsibility to proclaim the gospel. No contradiction in his mind between the complete sovereignty of God and human responsibility. We also see that Paul is addressing a question that comes up in his mind about whether God comes up in the mind of his readers about whether God has reneged on the promises God has made to his people. In fact, this is the flow of Romans 9. Paul begins the chapter by saying, look, I care so much about my own people, I would trade my own salvation if it meant they could be saved. He's using hyperbole there. He knows that can't happen, but he's saying, that's how much I love my people. And he says, they've had all these advantages and they've rejected God. And somebody says, but didn't God make promises to them? And he says, well, God made promises to his spiritual children, not necessarily to all of the physical descendants of Abraham. You've misunderstood the whole thing if you thought that just being born a Jew was going to make you a beneficiary of the promises of God. And he goes to show that that was true for the children of Abraham and the children of Isaac. Jacob I loved and Esau I hated is where he ends this up. And in fact, when you get to Jacob I've loved and Esau I hated, now somebody says, well, now wait, that doesn't sound fair. That doesn't sound just. How can God be just if these two children, before they've done anything, God ordains one for blessing and one for destruction? Well, it's not fair, but it is just. We saw it last week. And there's a difference, by the way, between fairness and justice. Fairness is what our standards tend to lean toward. Justice is in the heart and mind of God. And as we saw last week in verses 14 through 18, when God blesses anyone, it's an act not of justice, but of mercy. God is demonstrating mercy when he chooses to bless anyone. And when God, when Moses pleaded with God for mercy for the children of Israel, God responded to their sin with mercy. And God is free to do that. And it's not unjust for him to do that. But at the same time, when Pharaoh continued to reject God over and over again, God brought judgment to Pharaoh. And so Paul ends this whole discussion by saying, God has mercy on who he will, and God will harden who he will. And that's just for him to do that. Now, as we said last week, people read this verse and they said, well, this sounds arbitrary. It sounds wrong. It can't mean this. And that brings us to where we are this morning in verse 19, where Paul, after he says, God hardens whom he wills, somebody says the question, well, how can he still hold people accountable for their own actions if he's hardening their heart? And some of you have read ahead and you know how he answers that question, but let's look together at these verses and see what insight they give us into a tough theological issue. Before we read our passage, so let's pray together this morning. Father, we have to admit that this passage is not intellectually hard to understand. The reason and the logic are clear, but indeed these things are hard for our hearts to get around. There are things unknown in this passage. There is a wisdom beyond us. Some of these things just don't sound right or are counterintuitive, and we just ask that you would speak to us by your Spirit through your word this morning and give us insight and help us understand what we can of your mind and your heart in salvation. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you follow along. I'm going to read Romans 9. I'm going to read 10 verses starting at verse 19, actually 11 verses, 19 through 29. You follow as I read. You will say to me then, but why does he still find fault? For who can resist God's will? But who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Will what is molded say to its molder, why have you made me like this? Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? What if God, desiring to show his wrath and to make known his power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, in order to make known the riches of his glory for the vessels of mercy which he has prepared beforehand for glory, even us, whom he has called not from the Jews only, but from the Gentiles? As indeed it says in Hosea, those people who were not my people, I will call my people. And her who was not beloved, I will call beloved. And in the very place where it was said of them, you are not my people, they will be called sons of the living God. And Isaiah cries out concerning Israel, though the number of the sons of Israel be as the sands of the sea, only a remnant of them will be saved, for the Lord will carry out his sentence upon the earth fully and without delay. And as Isaiah predicted, if the Lord of hosts has not left us offspring, we would have been like Sodom and become like Gomorrah. Amen. May God bless this reading of his word. Let me give you the outline for what we're going to look at from this passage this morning. Five things we see from this section of Romans 9. First, it's okay to question God, but it's not okay to accuse him. It's okay to have questions and to bring those questions to God, but you don't want to bring an accusing tone before the God of the universe. Number two, your heart is harder than you realize. Your commitment to sin goes deeper than you really believe. Number three, God is God, you're not. Number four, the chief end of God is to glorify God. We've often heard the chief end of man is to glorify God. That's true. The chief end of God is to glorify God as well. And number five, it should be no surprise. All of this should be no surprise to anybody who has read their Old Testament carefully. This is not a New Testament concept. This was in the Old Testament as well. So back to verse 19, where Paul anticipates the question readers are going to ask him when he says, God hardens some, he shows mercy to some. Verse 19, why does God still find fault? For who can resist his will? Now let me say something about this question. In the verse right before this, where Paul has said he has grace and mercy for some and hardens others, you keep in mind the king's heart, it channels the king, God channels the heart of the king. Paul knows that if his readers have understood what he's saying correctly, they will have an objection and saying, how can God find fault? This is an appropriate objection. Now, this would have been the perfect place for Paul to step in with this objection and say, no, you've misunderstood me. I don't mean that God chooses some and not others. I don't mean that God shows favor and mercy to some and not others. He could have cleared up the whole thing right here. But he doesn't. Which means that the correct understanding of what Paul is teaching is that God hardens some and he shows mercy to others. And you go, well, wait, how can that? And Paul says, we'll get to that in just a second, but I want to make sure you understand, this is what is true. This is what he's teaching. The question that Paul anticipates would never have been asked if Paul had not been teaching exactly what we're saying he's teaching here. This question shows that Paul is in fact teaching predestination and election and God's sovereignty and salvation. God has mercy on some and he hardens others. And it is just for him to do so. In fact, justice would look like this. If God had no mercy, what would justice look like? All are under judgment. So it is just for God to bring judgment to all men. The fact that he shows mercy to some is not incongruent with his justice. God hardens a heart. We talked about this last week. God hardens hearts. Not by actively bringing evil into the heart of men, but by restraining any grace that he has given to them so that their own heart gets hardened. In fact, you've probably seen this experience where all you have to do for somebody to harden their own heart is you have to go and talk to them about Jesus. When Jesus is in front of them, the response is either a soft heart toward Jesus or a hard heart toward Jesus. So one of the ways God hardens people's hearts is he brings Jesus in front of them. He brings himself before them, and then it's up to them whether they're going to respond with a soft heart or a hard heart. Listen, there is no problem with having questions about how this works. In fact, the Bible, Paul's putting these questions in here. Paul's modeling for us. It's okay to ask these questions. You read the Psalms. The Psalms are full of questions for God about his ways and his purposes, aren't they? And that's the hymn book of Israel, inspired by the Holy Spirit, where God says, I want you to sing these questions to me regularly. So having questions for God about, well, how am I to understand this? What? How do I make sense of this? That's entirely appropriate. But there is a fine line between saying, I don't understand, and this is a mistake. Right? You know, with your children, when they come to you with questions, help me understand why we're doing this. There's a difference between that and saying, I don't think we should be doing this. I think this is wrong. I don't like it. And what Paul is saying right here as we get into these verses, he's saying, it's okay to ask these questions, but wait just a second. When you start making accusations about God, is he unjust? Is this wrong for him to do this? Now we've got a second thing. John Stott says, Paul is not censuring someone who asks sincere, perplexed questions, but rather someone who quarrels with God or who talks back or answers back. Such a person manifests a reprehensible spirit of rebellion against God, a refusal to let God be God and acknowledge his or her true status as the creature and the sinner. And F.F. Bruce says, it is the God-defying rebel and not the bewildered seeker after truth whose mouth Paul peremptorily shuts here. So the question, when you have these questions, you have to ask, are you a bewildered seeker? Or are you a God-defying rebel? When you wrestle with this whole idea of sovereignty election and predestination? Are you wrestling with it as somebody who is ready to submit to God's will as soon as you understand it? Or are you wrestling with it saying, I don't think this is the way it ought to be? There's a big difference. Actually, the question in verse 19 is pretty much the same as the question back in verse 14. Verse 14, he said, how can this be just? In verse 19, how can God hold men accountable? It's really justice is at play in both places. So Paul took the first question, and he answered it, and then get to the second question. He goes, well, now it sounds not like you have a question, but like you're arguing back with God. You're quarreling with him. And what is behind the idea that people go, God shouldn't hold us accountable for these things if he's hardening people's hearts? What's behind that idea is a failure to understand the reality of how deep our sin goes. What's behind it is we really don't believe our hearts are as hard as they are. We brought that up in the outline here. See, here's the thing. Most of us think about ourselves or about others that we are mostly good-hearted people. If you ask the average person on the street, are people mostly good or mostly bad? They will say, people are mostly good, they just have a few bad habits. That's how I thought of myself for decades. I was a mostly good person with a few bad habits. That's not the biblical understanding of the reality of your heart. Most of the time, here's the key question, most of the time, do we do the right thing or the wrong thing? Well, the answer to that is most of the time we do whatever we think is right. It's not whether it's morally right or wrong, it's who's in charge. See, the hard heart says, I'll be in charge of my own life and I'll let Jesus in if I need him from time to time. But the soft-hearted person is somebody who says, my life is yielded to him. I will obey him. Most of the time, we do what suits us, what pleases us. We do what glorifies us. If what we do fits in with what God wants, we're happy for that. We're happy to go along, but at the end of the day, we're going to do what we want to do. And sometimes, the way God hardens people's hearts is simply by showing up and being God. That's what he did with Pharaoh. Pharaoh was doing exactly what he wanted to do. And how did Pharaoh's heart get hardened? Moses kept coming in and saying, let my people go. That's what God wants. And every time Moses did that, Pharaoh's heart got a little harder. And then every time God sent a plague in response to Pharaoh's rejection, Pharaoh's heart got a little harder against God. He responded to God's presence not by submitting, but by hardening his heart. And when you don't get your way, don't you harden your heart? Sometimes, when life isn't going the way you want to, don't you have this tendency to go, this isn't fair? It shouldn't be like this? It is perfectly just for God to find fault with us. In fact, that's why in verse 20, Paul answers the question, how can this be fair? How can God do this? He answers it with another question. And I've always read this as, just who in the world do you think you are? With that kind of an accusatory tone. And I don't know if it's a stern rebuke here or a gentle rebuke, but the rebuke is aimed toward a person who is doing the protesting here. The rebuke is, you need to stop and examine who you really are and who God really is. That's the rebuke that's at play here. Just wait just a second. You're stopping and you're saying, how can God hold me accountable for my actions if he hardens people's hearts? Hang on just a second. You know who God is? And you know who you are? Do you have those in proper perspective? The question that Paul wants his readers and all of us to consider at this point is, if God does not show you mercy and instead he chooses to judge you for your sin, would it be perfectly appropriate for him to do that, considering the way that you behave toward him and toward others? Now think about that for just a second. If God chose not to show you mercy, but instead brought destruction and judgment, would it be appropriate for him to do that? And if there's something in the back of your head that says, well, I'm not that bad, then you haven't caught the point of this passage yet. Jonathan Edwards preached a whole sermon on this subject, a sermon called The Justice of God in the Damnation of Sinners. Which, if you put it in the church bulletin, people will take that Sunday off, right? Who wants to hear that sermon? But let me tell you, in that sermon, Edwards says, we need to examine your record, and let's see what you deserve from God. I'm just going to paraphrase some of what Edwards said in this sermon, Because the question that Paul is asking, who are you, O man, to answer back to God, really goes to, do you understand just how deep your rebellion and your sin goes? Here's what Edwards said. He said, you have not, as people outside of the church, if before you knew Christ, you did not show any particular affection or love for God. When people are in love, they think of the loved one constantly. They want to be with that person. They're always thinking of what they can do to demonstrate their love for the other person. That's what people who are in love do. Did you do that for God before you knew him? You've not done that. Do you think often of God? In fact, do you think of him at all? Well, you think of him to blame him when things don't go exactly the way you'd like. You don't want to be with God. You didn't, before you were a Christian, you didn't go to church. You didn't spend time in prayer or in Bible study. You didn't care about those things. You've not shown any particular affection or love toward God. If that's true, why should God be obliged to love you or to show you mercy or grace? Why should he be obliged to show you any favor whatsoever? Edwards goes on, you've slighted God in thousands of ways throughout your entire life. Everything you are and everything you have comes from God, but you've not been thankful for that. You've thought, I earned this. Nor have you made any serious effort to find out why God has given you the abilities and advantages and opportunities you've been given. And you use these opportunities and abilities for yourself, trying to accumulate as much money or pleasure or praise as possible without any thought of God. Why should God pay attention to you in any saving way when you have neglected his bountiful gifts and favors? But it's not just God the Father you've rejected. Edwards goes on, you also despise the work of the Son of God, the Lord Jesus. It would have been just of God if he had rejected you outright without ever having offered you a Savior, but God has not done that. He provided a Savior, his Son, Jesus, the most wonderful, most holy, most merciful, most gracious person who ever walked the surface of the earth. The Father offered him up to death in the place of sinners like you, but you don't care. You care only for your own pleasure. You ignore Jesus completely. If he were here in person to confront you for your sinful behavior and tell you to repent, you would, if the truth be told, easily find yourself in a crowd like on that day crying out for him to be crucified. If God should cast you off forever, wouldn't that be the most just and reasonable thing in the world in light of your treatment of him and of Jesus Christ? See, most people walking the streets today, most people who don't know Christ, they think, I'm okay with God. You know, I thank the good Lord upstairs, the man upstairs. They'll have that kind of language. But their heart is so self-focused, so self-interested, as mine was, as yours was, before God did a transforming work in our hearts. And so for God to decide that he's going to make a lump of clay fitted for destruction, we need to recognize our hearts were hard from the beginning. Our rejection of God began in the beginning. We don't have a problem with the doctrine of election until we get to the correct understanding of our, after we get to the correct understanding of our depravity, then we can begin to see it. I need to stop here and just say, have you realized how hard your own heart is apart from God's work in your life? Because I believe that until you see that, you can't really understand and embrace God's grace as fully and as freely as it needs to be understood. The hymn writer says it this way, guilty, vile, and helpless we. Spotless Son of God was he. True atonement, can it be? Hallelujah, what a Savior. When Marianne and I were first married, I had a side job. I worked from home in the evenings and made radio commercials that got sent out to radio stations around the country, and I did it for different clients, and I had to come up with a name for my company. And so I had labels, square yellow labels that I would put on the box of these, on the tape boxes that I would send out. This was back in the old days, children, when there were audio tapes that we sent out to people. And my company name, the name I called my company at that point was Romans 9 Productions. And the reason for that is because this chapter was a chapter God used powerfully in my own life to look me in the eye and say, wait, just a second, who are you? Who do you think you are? Do you understand who God is? Do you understand who you are? And that was a transforming moment in my spiritual walk. I needed to bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art, right? That's what Paul wants us to see when he talks about this potter and clay illustration that he uses in verses 20 through 22. And the point he's making with the potter and the clay illustration is the third point in our outline, God is God, you're not God. Will what is molded say to the molder, why have you made me like this? And does the potter have no right over the clay to make out of the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? Here's some homework for you. There are four passages in the Old Testament that Paul is citing here when he pulls this together. Four passages that talk about the potter and the clay. And we're not going to look at all four of them this morning, but I'll just give them to you. There are three of them in Isaiah. And there's one in Jeremiah, and you can write these down and go home and read them this afternoon if you want to see how Isaiah talked about God as the potter and us as the clay, and how Jeremiah addressed it. But the point of the illustration, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, is clear. There is a disparity between who God is and who you are. And most of us think that disparity is like this when it's like this, right? Most of us think it's like this when it's like this. The distance between, we're created in the image of God, which means that God has given us aspects of the divine nature. That's a wonderful thing. That's why we're close to him, but God is so far from us. He is, as one theologian liked to say, he is the holy other. Whatever you are, God is different than that. Imagine for a minute that you had a child who was born to you, and from the first day this child was born, this child resisted your leadership and your authority in the home. Some of you go, I don't have to imagine this, right? Child came into the world with a, I'm in charge, it's all about me. Imagine that this child routinely disrespected you, ignored you, disobeyed you. In fact, when the child got old enough, the child said, I'm going to change my last name because I don't want to be associated with this family. And completely rejects you in that moment. Imagine that, okay? Now imagine for a second that your net worth is $17 trillion. That's nice to imagine, isn't it? And imagine your son saying to you, you know what, I don't care. I don't care about your money. I don't want to have anything to do with it. Would there be anyone who would say to you, you know, it would be wrong for you to cut your son off from his inheritance and to write him out of your will? Anybody who would say that, if that was the track record with that son? It's not up to the father, or is it not up to the father to determine what happens with rebellious children? And in fact, if that father in that moment said, you know what, I'm going to give an inheritance to that son, and I'm my prayer is that his heart will soften and he will change. For that father to show that act of mercy, is that within his prerogative? Is it unjust for him to do that? You see, that's the story we're talking about here. All of us were born with that hard, rebellious heart that said, I don't want anything to do with God unless it suits me. I'm not interested in this unless it suits me. In fact, I'm not going to call myself a Christian unless it suits me. I don't care about the inheritance. I don't care about him, and I don't care about any of that. Is it not right for God to say, okay? And is it not merciful for God to say, no, I'm still going to bless you? Let me go back to where we started this morning. Did the people God created have a personal responsibility in their rebellion against God? Yes. Paul's not teaching that we are puppets or animatrons here. He's not throwing out human responsibility. But he is saying that if it pleases God to, from that same lump, make some who are vessels of mercy who will be adopted into his family, is that not okay for God to do that? In fact, it is, and we should do what Job does in that moment when we say, instead of, I don't get that, we should just put our hands over our mouth, and we should say, you can do all things, No purpose of yours can be thwarted. Therefore, I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me which I did not know. I repent in dust and ashes. When you're confronted with the sovereignty of God, and you go, instead of saying, that's not fair, or I don't agree, you just go like that. The psalmist says it this way in Psalm 115. Why should the nations say, where is their God? Our God is in the heavens. He does all that he pleases. God's job description is he does whatever pleases him. The point is, potter, clay. We are so far below God that we have neither the wisdom nor the right to question him. Instead, we should respond with, have thine own way, Lord. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will, while I'm waiting, yielded and still. Tim Keller says we must beware of standing in judgment over God rather than remembering that he is the judge over us. And we must most of all beware of recreating God in a way that is more pleasant or palatable rather than acknowledging that he is the creator. Paul says, here's what you need to understand out of all of this. When God shows mercy to some, that brings him glory. When God brings destruction to the wicked who have rebelled against him and rejected him, that brings him glory as well. Because God is committed to his own glory. God does what he does because it brings glory to him. God's reasons for why he does what he does is because he will do what brings the most glory to him. Paul says, let me give you a thought here. What if God says, I'm going to demonstrate my power and my wrath, but first I'll be patient. This is what he's saying in verse 23. What if God says, I'm going to demonstrate this, but first I'm going to be patient. I'm going to endure rejection and rebellion for a long time, but ultimately I'm going to bring judgment on those who have rejected me. Is that fair for God to do? Of course it is. And when he does that, when he displays his power and his might and his righteousness by bringing judgment on the wicked, will his glory be on display in that moment? Yes, sir. So, why does God show mercy to some and not others? And here's the other side of it. When God shows grace to those in that day of judgment, when he shows grace to those, will his glory be on display in the showing of the grace? Yes. So God will be glorified when he brings judgment to some, and he'll be glorified when he brings mercy to others. But the question is, why does he do it the way he does it? Why does he show mercy to some and not others? Well, part of the answer is because God's going to be glorified in both mercy and in judgment. But the question is, why doesn't God save everyone? That's what we're really asking, and here's how Tim Keller answers that. Paul seems to be saying that God's chosen course to save some and leave others will, in the end, be more fit to show forth his glory than any other scheme we can imagine. This may seem strange to us, but that's the point. We're not God. We can't know everything or decide what's best. Now, with all of that said, Paul wraps up this section by saying, this ought to be obvious to anybody who's read their Old Testament. He's going back to the question in verse 6, where he says, has he neglected the promises to Israel? Has he reneged on those promises? He comes back to that and says, you need to understand, what I'm telling you here has been spoken of by the prophets throughout Old Testament history. This should be nothing new to you if you've read your Bible and you know your Bible. By the way, I just have to remind you, most people didn't have a Bible. Paul had large portions of the Old Testament memorized, and when he's making these arguments, he's pulling verses out of his head. He's not going to his computer or his concordance and saying, where does God talk about this? That's how steeped in the scriptures he was, that he can pull this out. So he wraps up this section by saying, this has been evident throughout the Old Testament. The Old Testament has taught that God would bless both Jews and Gentiles. That idea is found throughout the Old Testament. Israel thought it was just them, but God has been saying for years, no, it's going to be both Jews and Gentiles. There will be an incoming of the Gentiles. For example, he says, look in Hosea. Hosea says, those who were not my people, the Gentiles, I will call my people. And to her who was not beloved, the Gentiles, I will call beloved. And in the very place where it was said to them, you're not my people, that would be in the Holy Land, they will be called sons of the living God. So the prophet Hosea has been declaring, along with the other prophets, God's got a plan for the Gentiles. God has always promised that he would bless and show mercy, not just to Jews, but to Gentiles. If you've read your Old Testament carefully, you would know this has been his plan from the beginning. Should we be surprised that God would show grace and mercy to people who don't deserve it? No, that's what God does all the time. What God is doing with the Gentiles now, Paul says, in the time of Romans, he says, what God is doing with this outpouring of grace to the Gentiles is really no different than what God did when he came to Abraham in Ur and said, I'm going to make a mighty nation out of you. I'm going to bless you. If God can do that with Abraham in Ur and start the whole Jewish nation, can he not come to the Gentiles with the same grace? Paul says it should also come as no surprise to anybody who's read the Old Testament that God's blessing was never for every descendant of Abraham, but always for a remnant of Israel. In fact, that's what Isaiah says, verse 27. Isaiah cries out concerning Israel, though the number of the sons of Israel be as the sand of the sea. Now, remember Abraham in Genesis 15, where God takes him out and says, look at the stars, Abraham. Your descendants will be as many as those, many as the stars, as many as the sand in the sea. How much sand is there in the sea? You couldn't count the grains. Your descendants, Abraham, will be as many as the stars in the sky or the sands in the sea, but only a remnant of them will be saved. For the Lord will carry out his sentence upon the earth fully and without delay. And then he reminds the Jewish readers that Isaiah told them long ago that there was really nothing special about them or nothing commendable about them or nothing lovely about them that caused God to show his grace to them. In fact, he says, if the Lord of hosts had not left us an offspring, we would have been like Sodom and Gomorrah. So again, these verses we learn, number one, it's okay to question, but it's not okay to question or to accuse or argue back with God. Your heart is really harder than you realized. God is God, you're not. God's chief end is to glorify himself, and all of this should come as no surprise to anybody who's been reading their Old Testament. Let me wrap up this section of Scripture and this conversation about election and predestination with a great illustration I heard from D. James Kennedy. He's a former pastor at Coral Ridge Presbyterian Church in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. He says, let's say there are five people who are planning to hold up a bank. They're all friends of mine. I find out about their plan, and I plead with them. I beg them not to do it. Finally, they push me out of the way, and they start out. I tackle one of the men and wrestle him to the ground, and the others go ahead, rob the bank, kill a guard, and they are captured, convicted, and sentenced. The man I tackled was not involved in the robbery, so he is free. Now, let me ask you the question. Whose fault was it that the other men were sentenced and died? And who gets the credit for the other man walking around free? Can the other man say, because my heart was so good, I'm a free man? The only reason he's free is because of me. I restrained him. So Kennedy says, all who go to hell have no one to blame but themselves. Those who go to heaven have no one to praise but Jesus. Thus we see that salvation is all of grace from the beginning to the end. Now, do you still have unanswered questions about God's sovereignty, his purposes in election, predestination? I do. So did John Calvin, right? The guy whose name's associated with all of this stuff. Why did God save some and not others? Here's how Calvin answers that. He says, when it is asked why the Lord did so, we must answer, because he pleased. But if you proceed farther to ask why he pleased, you ask for something greater and more sublime than the will of God, and nothing else can be found. God's will has to be our ultimate resting place. Why did God do this? It pleased him. But I want to know more. No. That's beyond you and us. That brings us here to the table. Salvation is of the Lord. It is of God's doing. God will one day pour out judgment on the wicked. What about the rest of us? God has poured out the judgment we deserve. One day, the wicked will be judged and will face God's wrath. You won't, because Jesus faced it for you. Because as we sang this morning, till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid. This is the table where we come face to face with the price that was paid, where God said, you are not my people, but now you are my people. You are not my beloved, but now you are my beloved. And that's what's pictured for us in the bread and the juice, the price that was paid so that God could say that to us. We practice what's called open communion here at Redeemer, which means that we leave it to you and your conscience to determine whether you should come and get bread and juice. And here's what I would say to you. If your heart has been softened, you have yielded to God, you have surrendered your life to him, you can say, he is my God, he has called me his beloved, then you're welcome to come and receive the elements and participate in this family meal. If you're here this morning and you say, that's not true of me, number one, we're glad you're here. This is a good place for you to be, to consider these things. But I would encourage you not to come and get bread and juice this morning, because that would be not only unwise, but it would be wrong of you to participate in a family meal if you've rejected the family, if you're outside of the family. So instead of coming and getting bread and juice, you might want to read what will be up on the screen, some prayers and some thoughts, and just ponder those things as we partake in this family meal. You prepare your hearts to come forward for communion while I prepare at the table. Thank you. this is what saves you from the wrath that is to come. Not a cracker and juice, but the broken body and shed blood of the Lord Jesus pictured in these elements. We believe that Christ is with us in a special way as we gather together in this moment for this time of communion. Jesus gathered with his disciples on the night before he was crucified, and at that Passover meal, during the meal he took bread and he broke it. He prayed a prayer of blessing and he passed it to his disciples. He said, "This bread is my body, broken and torn for you. As often as you receive this bread, remember me." And Lord Jesus, that's what we do here this morning. We remember your grace and your goodness toward us. We remember that while we were far off, you drew near and brought us near. We remember that we would deserve judgment and punishment and eternal damnation if it weren't for your mercy. And so we're grateful for what you have done for us, for tackling us and rescuing us. We receive this now with grateful hearts as we feast on Christ in our hearts. After the meal was over, Jesus took the cup. He prayed a prayer of blessing. He passed the cup and he said, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant." God's making a new promise to his people. The new promise is a promise of mercy. Not a promise of law, but a promise of grace. And he said, "As often as you drink this, remember forgiveness of sin." And so, Lord, this morning, that's what we remember, that our sins have been separated from us by the power of Christ, that you have paid, Lord Jesus, for our sin with your own blood. And we receive this now with grateful hearts as we feast on Christ in our hearts. Amen. I want us to stand, and with hearts of expectation, we're going to sing one verse of O Come, Emmanuel. Let's sing the verse about Jesse's, the stem of Jesse. Do we have that one? The branch of Jesse's stem. This is appropriate with Romans chapter 9 to sing about the branch of Jesse's stem. Let's sing this verse and chorus together, and then I'll dismiss us with a benediction. Trusting in God's unfailing love and faithfulness. God will not abandon you, for you are the work of his hands, his own creation, and his love endures forever. So go in joy to love and serve the Lord. Amen. As we dismiss, let me say thank you to Kathy Kroll and to the Vandenbergs and to Melanie Somke for the beautiful decorations here around the church this morning. Thank you, ladies. Have a wonderful week, and we'll see you back next Sunday.